7 weeks, a lot of my time has been spent trying to become up to speed on the history of the Tampa Bay Met, and previous to that, the Tampa Bay Express, and previous to that, the Tampa Interstate Study, and the whole history of all of the improvements that have evolved and gotten us to where we are today. And what I'm hoping to do is to be able to first tell you a little bit about where we are right now, what we're doing, the course that we're heading on right now, give you some information that hopefully will make sure you have current and accurate information. I think there's a lot of information out there. Some of it is probably very accurate. Others of it maybe is outdated, and I want to make sure you have the most recent information. I want to be able to answer any questions that you may have. So after I go through a short presentation, we'll have an opportunity for you to ask questions. And in addition, and probably more importantly than the questions you may have, I'd be very interested in hearing your thoughts and things that you would like us to take into account as we proceed forward with the Tampa Bay Next process. And I'll use the projector here to show you a few of the things here. Tampa Bay Next, and I want to make sure this is a very important differentiation from Tampa Bay Express to Tampa Bay Next. Tampa Bay Express was a project. It was a very large project that covered most of the interstate system in the Tampa Bay region. And the primary element of those projects, and that project was express toll lanes that would serve as the primary addition to the existing system. About 6-8 months ago or so, the DOT, in response to hearing a lot of input from the community, decided that it was time to take a step back and relook at what we're doing. And that's what kind of evolved into the Tampa Bay Next process. And so I want to make that differentiation. Tampa Bay Next is a process. Tampa Bay Express was a project. And so we're entering a process now, and what we're looking to do with this process is to reach out to the community to learn more about the things that you want us to take into account as we go forward with the transportation decisions that we make in the process going forward, and also to provide avenues for you to provide that input. And we'll cover a lot of that today. There really are four things that we're looking at in the Tampa Bay Next process. One is design. Some of our interstates were designed a long time ago, and they don't really work in today's environment. Probably the downtown interchange is one of the biggest ones that we can point to, as well as the West Shore interchange and certain other areas. Demand has grown significantly, and if you look at the land use decisions that have been made and continue to be made, the demand is not going to go down. It's going to continue to go up. In fact, if you look at the projections for 10, 15, 20 years out, if you think the traffic out there now is bad, imagine what it will be like when all that development comes into play and all of those people are trying to get around our communities and trying to get to work and to other places that they need to travel to. Just looking at choice. One of the things that we've heard consistently from most of all of the working groups that we've gone to is that people want choices. They don't want to just have the main choice they have now, which is to get in the car, drive someplace, and then drive back home. Most of the time, one person in the vehicle. You'd like to have options like transit being a big option that people want. And we'll talk about that a little bit more. Coming up with choices other than the historical norm, which has been a single occupant vehicle. And then looking to find consensus where we can. I'm well aware that we're never going to find total consensus with everyone. But what we can hope to do is to find consensus in some areas and find a series of projects and initiatives that will help be responsive to the consensus areas and the communities that we intersect. I know you can't read this, but what I wanted to throw this up here is to talk to you a little bit about where we are, because this is something that I think there's a little bit of a misperception at times. If you look over on the left side, right now we do have the Gateway project that has already been awarded to a contractor, and that's basically over in the St. Pete Airport over to the southern end of the Howard Franklin Bridge project. That's a currently ongoing project. And then the Howard Franklin Bridge, some of you may be aware, the Howard Franklin Bridge, the one of the bridges, the older bridge, is going to be structurally deficient in the next couple of years. What that means is that it's no longer serviceable in that that by law, we have to program a project to replace that bridge. We've done repairs over the years, we've poured millions of dollars into little fixes here and there, but this bridge has just gotten too old and we need to replace it. So when we replace this bridge, we're going to replace it with essentially a six-lane new bridge. And that six-lane new bridge is going to have four general-purpose lanes to match the four that are on the bridge that will remain, and two express lanes. We're also going to design those express lanes, when I talk about the structure that supports those two express lanes, to be able to handle future rail service, which might be a light rail service. We're basically going to say, let's design that bridge stronger, those lanes, so the future will be able to, if the community decides that that's something that they want, we can accommodate it on that bridge. When you look at the red, the blue, and the yellow, that's all inside of what we call the SEIS. I don't expect you to know what SEIS means. It stands for Supplemental Environmental Impact Study. What we did is, years and years ago, there was the Tampa Interstate Study that laid out a footprint. And at that time, they looked, this is 20-some years ago, and at the time, it said, this is the footprint that we think we need for our future interstate improvements. And it looked at what is that going to impact? What impact will it have to the environment? What impact will it have to the communities that we're going to be impacting by taking property and building roads in? And also, how do we mitigate that? And strategies will come up. Some of that you've seen in place is over time when the property's acquired in advance, trying to repair homes. Some historic properties have been relocated. All of that was part of that original environmental impact statement. What we're doing now as part of this reset is revisiting that section of it and looking at it again, saying we need to relook at what the current conditions are, perhaps compared to what it was back then. Look at new options, get more input from the community, and come up with our new, what else has to be done to make that work, but it's something we're looking at. We're also looking at whether express lanes, which were originally planned for that segment of 275, might not be better served on the I-75 corridor. So we're looking at some things that may be different from what we looked at in the past. The next slide here is just to show you where we are in the process. And you look way at the left, we're in the screening portion of it. That means we're in the very early stages. We haven't made decisions yet. So if you've heard that we've already decided and we're just going through the process, that's not true. We're going back and we're screening all these alternatives and we're looking at them in detail. And as we start to get further and further in the process, there'll be opportunities for you to participate in public meetings and to participate in workshops. We have community workshops all throughout the Tampa Bay region. You'll be able to come in and participate in that and give your input and see what we're planning. And then in a couple of years from now, we'll get to some sort of preferred alternative that hopefully will be something that will be the result of that consensus building process. This is a schedule that shows the SEIS. You don't really need to worry too much about it, but a couple of things. First, the study for the SEIS started in early 2017. It is scheduled to go to a record of decision, which is basically an acceptance by the Federal Highway Administration, in fall of 2019. But concurrently with that, we're doing a premium transit study, a regional transit study, because we want whatever comes out of this regional transit study to be a portion of the Tampa Bay Next process and ultimately what we decide to do with the Tampa Bay system, the roads and transit alternatives that we may come up with as our preferred alternatives. That, actually tonight they have a meeting over at the History Center. Some folks were over at that. They're having it in Pinellas, they're having it in Pasco. We're showing alternatives, and the purpose of that study, and long and short of it is, we're hoping that we can come up with one alternative to get started with that we can attract Federal Transit Administration funding. Because that's really the key to being able to do a significant transit project. The majority of the transit projects in the United States that have really taken off have had the federal money. Because if we can get the federal approval, we can get 50% of the cost of building whatever that transit solution is that we decide we want to pursue, paid by the federal government. That's one part of it. DOT so far has been the agency that has funded the study. We also have dedicated in next year's budget $5 million to do the next study, which is the study that we would have to do to meet the Federal Transit Administration requirements. So we are funding that. Now HART is managing the current project, but DOT is providing the funding. When we go into that next study, there's one critical part that we're going to need, in addition to the DOT's participation and ultimately the Federal Transit Administration's participation, and that's FTA will not provide funding to us unless there's also a local agency match. That means whatever local agencies that we happen to want to build a transit system within and apply for federal funding has to commit to providing 25% of the capital cost. Federal government will pay 50%. FDOT by law can pay 25%, which we would do. But that local government has to pay 25%, or we can't provide the match and FTA won't provide the funding. There also has to be a dedication on the part of the local agencies to maintain and operate that system once it's built. And so I'm saying that, and I've brought that message to the local agencies, to the MPOs, to let them know that a year or so from now, we're going to be looking for that commitment so that we can go to the FTA. If we don't have that commitment, it really does us no good to go to the FTA. So that is something that we are very actively pursuing. If you hear that DOT's anti-transit, if you hear that we're pro-transit, we're actually neither. I'd love personally to see a great transit system in Tampa Bay. It'd be another choice for us to have ways to get around. But it's not really DOT's choice. We will do everything we can to help fund the process to get to the point where we need that local commitment. So just keep that in mind as we're talking about local options for transit. And there's lots of different things that we've been looking at for transit. You know, here are some options that you could look at. One would be, could we run transit buses down the middle of the interstate system and use express buses in those areas that would get around a lot faster than just sitting in the regular traffic lanes? Can we run them on existing hard shoulders, paved shoulders? That's another option we can look at. We can look at perhaps light rail on the side of the interstate. There are lots of options we're looking at, and I encourage you to get involved with the premium transit study if you haven't had a chance to yet, because your input is going to be important on that. That's a major part of the decision making that goes into the preferred route. Now, how can you participate in the process? We're having meetings almost, I'd say, just about every day with some group in the community, between whether it's here, whether it's out in Plant City, whether it's in Pasco County, whether it's in Nellis County. We're getting around to get as many people involved in this to give us their input as we can. We have community working groups that are forming, and if you haven't had a chance to come to one of those meetings yet, there's a lot of information online where you can find out. We've got a lot of our folks here today. We've got some of our folks here in the audience that can tell you more about how to get involved with those. But those are going to meet on a regular basis as we go through this process. And so that's your chance to get involved with that. The other thing that we're doing is what we're calling the Citizens Transportation Academy. And I'll be the first to admit that a lot of the things we do in DOT and the federal government are not that easy to understand just by picking up a manual or looking on their website and trying to figure out the process. We're trying to simplify that so that folks who aren't in the business every day of transportation can learn more about some of the things that we have to do in order to make some of these transportation alternatives happen. We have about the no TBNs. I wanted to know about the folks in Tampa Heights and Seminole Heights and Ybor City, the folks who had been involved in the process, many of them that weren't very happy with the way that, one, we were proceeding with the project, and perhaps, two, how we were communicating with the community. And I wanted to better understand that, because I'm hopeful that we can get past whatever may have happened in the past and make this a very productive and fruitful process going forward. And one of the best ways I can say to do that is hopefully open communications with people who in the past maybe felt they didn't have that opportunity. I was very happy when I was invited to come over, and I came over just yesterday with Lena and Rick and Ben, and talked to folks that have been leaders in the forefront of the community. And I can tell you, I learned a good amount. I asked a lot of questions. I got a lot of frank answers. I got a lot of good input. I learned a lot about some things that I wasn't really aware of were some of the major concerns. But I can tell you, they are very passionate about this whole process in the community. You should be proud that they represent you. They represent you well, and I look forward to continuing to work with them as we go forward. I understand that you all want to have a community that's going to be here for your children and grandchildren, and you want to be able to have a community that's healthy, that's someplace that you can have folks walk and bike and all of that. And you also want to look for ways for us to reduce impacts to your community with whatever it is that we come up with for the Tampa Bay Next improvements. Another thing, it may not be a big thing right now, but one of the things we're looking at is workforce development. We're thinking we're going to come through a lot of communities and build a lot of things. Workforce development is important. Construction jobs, right now, we have a shortage. And I know there's people that probably would be interested. So as we start to develop these projects, we're going to look to the community to look for opportunities to partner with you for workforce development so that the people that are building some of these projects are the people that live in those communities.
The various corridors that you control in order to take advantage of that match, or is this a match that could be used wherever the community decided is the best opportunity and the best corridor?
Well, and I'm going to ask the guys to correct me if I say anything.
In other words, if we went up the railroad track and we concluded that was the best way, is that something that we could still take advantage of the 75-25?
If that was determined to be an appropriate, and that you can sell that to the Federal Transit Administration as a viable, they're going to look at all of the financial viability, they're going to look at the commitments. I'll use SunRail as an example in Orlando. I even asked a question myself. I said, what made SunRail happen? That was, just to get an idea compared to maybe where we are. And what I learned was one of the big things for the Federal Transit Administration was that the MPO in Orlando, they prioritized that project as the number one priority for the region. They also had four counties in the city of Orlando all pledged to put up their match and to also go ahead and take on the maintenance and operations of the system. And because of that, Federal Transit said, okay, we're in. And so part of that was they purchased rail rights in the Orlando area. So I would say anything is really possible, but you still have to pass the FTA requirements. So, whether something on an existing rail line would meet their requirements when you look at the cost of it. Unfortunately, CSX doesn't just give away their lines. They aren't cheap to get. And so all that has to be weighed into it. So it's just part of that process.
So in regard to the local match, did Orlando go by referendum or just by vote of their various authorities?
My understanding is that none of them had a referendum that was specifically tied to transit, maintenance, and operations. I think it's supposed to, I've heard the latest estimates was it was going to be about $40 to $50 million a year that was split between, I don't know how they proportioned it, but Volusia County, Orange County, Seminole County, Osceola County, and the city of Orlando. And so how they fund it, I don't know.
Are you impressed with the rebranding or new approach to our transportation or transit issues? And so is the FDOT now considering that this might be going out for a platinum and vision certified award when it's completed?
Yes.
She teaches sustainability at the University of South Florida, and she's been asking us for several years now to go out for some sort of, similar to what they did in Orlando, to go for a sustainability award, or it's a certification, and we committed to doing that actually last year, again, pending a lot of these discussions, but we do intend to move forward with it. Yes.
All right.
How do you engage USF anymore in this process, meaning the students and the faculty who teach courses? And I'll go back a little bit. We have an Office of Community Engagement that's built a lot of its reputation in working with East Tampa. Things have changed over the past year, and now we've set in this process where for community to work with us through that office, they have to pay $10,000. And the in that particular city. So for example, this semester, the city is Dunedin. And I was all living, and then I checked the demographics of Dunedin, and I was like, you know, I've been working in East Town for such a long time, it's sort of a really different demographic for me to move to. And so you speak about workforce development, and tomorrow I'm going to be at the Tampa Vocational Institute doing green infrastructure with these guys who at the end of a month are of this green construction program are looking for jobs. And so here we're talking about new approaches to stormwater management, but there's no demand for green infrastructure in the city. So it's a question to FDOT, because a lot of your infrastructure, you know, is managed by our traditional stormwater. And so are there options to consider building workforce? It's not just for constructing the roadways, but for how we manage the water coming off of your infrastructure.
Well, we're starting a number of things now. Part of this whole reset was we're looking at the workforce development. I'd encourage you afterwards, come talk to us so we can get you with the right people to because we are looking for folks that want to participate and have good ideas. You know, for stormwater management, we were talking this morning about certain things. You know, we look at ponds. We thought, you know, maybe we can find a way to use some of that for reclaimed water. You know, there's other types of innovations out there now that we might be able to take advantage of.